Let me introduce for tonight's festivities Attorney Zach Messa from Johnson Polk, etc. et al. Here in Clearwater. And I'm just going to turn it over to him, give your attention to Zach, and off we go.
How you all doing tonight? My name is Zach, and I'm a certified intellectual property attorney by certified by the bar. So that means that a majority of my practice is with intellectual property. And I understand that you're all business law class, correct?
Yes.
All right, so I reviewed your chapter, and it has all the nuts and bolts about all the dry stuff for intellectual property. So what I want to do is try to kind of push through some of that stuff, and let's get to what really goes on in the real world. Now, I know you all have a project you're doing for a nonprofit, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So what I'd like to do is probably maybe about 30 minutes in, let's just shift our focus on your development of your nonprofit and how intellectual property applies to that. Because that's a real life scenario to where you can go ahead and see how it pertains to what you want to do, whether you're an entrepreneur, you're still doing a startup, or if you're going to go work for someone else in a firm. You need to be aware of intellectual property nowadays because it's everywhere. I mean, everyone carries around your own personal computer in your pocket or inside your suit pocket. And that is just packed with other people's property. Just because you can view it, you can look at it, you can navigate through it, doesn't mean you own it. Other people own it. And the purpose of the intellectual property laws, which consists of patent, trademark, trade secrets, and the last one, copyrights, is to foster innovation, because that's what America is. I mean, it's people that come here, and it's a land of opportunity. So when someone comes up with a new idea or a new music, in order to present it to the public, what Congress has done through the Copyright Act and through other acts is that they bestow certain exclusive rights on these individuals who own that property. Now, usually it's not something that you can touch and you can feel and you can put in your back pocket, but even though it doesn't have that tangible aspect to it, it is an intangible asset that's very valuable. As a matter of fact, I think it's something like 80% of all US-based companies, 80% of their valuation is based on their intellectual property portfolio. So however you comprise it, whether you're trademark heavy, if you're copyright heavy, whatever it may be, it can't be overlooked. In fact, for startup companies, if you're looking for venture capitalist firms, people that come along and invest money into your company in order for you to get it off the ground, or even angel investors, they're going to look to make sure that your intellectual property portfolio is in order, because essentially they're investing in that property and they want to make sure that they're going to yield the return that they want to yield through their investment. So I think we already said the three areas of intellectual property. And
try to down there.
There we go. So let's go to patent. Patents are usually filed by patent attorneys. Patent attorneys, they take a patent bar, and they usually have some type of engineer background. A patent is a document that you file with the patent office, and what it gives the patent owner is exclusive rights or a monopoly over the patented product. Now, that's unlike some of the other intellectual property rights to where you don't enjoy complete exclusivity. And in exchange for getting that patent, the government will say, well, we're going to give you exclusive rights for so many years, as long as you provide instructions in your patent that upon the expiration of those years, someone can go ahead and make that patented product. Now, there's the design patent, there's a utility patent, and a plant patent. A utility patent involves a mechanical, electrical, chemical process, etc. You can read the slide. The duration of that patent is 21 years from the date of filing. And a majority of all patents filed are utility patents. So what does that mean? So that means, for instance, you come up with an idea or an invention. All right, you want to take that invention and you want to determine whether or not you have patent rights in it. If the invention is some type of mechanical device, let's say it's a better can opener, and there's something unique and not and novel about that better can opener, what you can do is you can go ahead and apply to the patent office to get a patent on that product. And if you're successful in getting it, you can prohibit any other person from manufacturing that product. And we'll get back when we go to the second part of the presentation as to, you know, how it applies in the real world with respect to businesses. You can go ahead and now start to monetize that, meaning that you can gain money through that through either manufacturing that product or licensing it, the right to manufacture it to others. Now, a design patent, on the other hand, is just an it's just a essentially an appearance. It's not a function. Now, I think the most famous design patent is the Coca-Cola bottle. The Coca-Cola bottle, we're all familiar with that little 1 pound, that little 1 ounce bottle. That, I think I have it up here. It's right here. That patent was filed back in the early 1900s. Okay, it has since expired. So you're probably wondering why people aren't just knocking off that Coca-Cola bottle right and left. That's where trademarks come into play. And we'll talk about that when we get to it. So there's all these intricacies among these different types of intellectual property that if you just have an idea, just be able to identify them, you're halfway there. Because a lot of companies and startups do not even understand what they have, how they protect it, or what they want to go after for protection. Now, a plant patent, that's basically developing a new plant. You just can't go ahead and cross-pollinate two seeds. You have to go through a biomedical process in order to develop this new plant. And I am not sure how many farmers there are right here, but it's not really a common type of patent in the patent office. The patent requirements. So you have an idea or you have an invention that you want to determine whether or not you can gain patent protection. Well, these requirements provide some type of guidance as to whether or not it is a patentable invention. For instance, it has to be novel, meaning that it's not previously patented or described in previously printed publications. That's what they call in the industry prior art. So when you go, you have an invention, and you decide that, you know, I really like to go ahead and see if I can get a patent on this invention, the first thing you want to do is just start Googling and see if you can find anything else out there that even resembles what you're trying to invent. If there's something else out there, you're not immediately precluded, because a patent, the way it's drafted, has certain claims in it. And each of the claims are the patentable portion of the product over which you're getting a patent on. So it's possible that maybe some of your unique aspects or novel aspects of your product or your invention would be able to qualify for a patent. Usually to get real in-depth analysis as to whether or not it's novel or there's prior art out there, you'd have to go to a patent attorney and they basically run a search for you as to everything else out that's under the sun to determine whether or not there's any prior art that would block your patent. Non-obvious. All right, so I invent a can opener. Great. Well, how many people out there have invented can openers before? Well, I want to use my can opener to open, you know, some type of different apparatus than a mere can. Well, if it's an obvious extension of the use of that product, well, then you're not going to get a patent over it because it's not novel, it's not unique. It's an obvious extension to where they're not going to grant you those rights. Useful. Patent has to do something. It can't be some type of abstract idea. It has to have some type of useful purpose in order to obtain that protection. And then finally, it has to be a patentable subject matter. And mere ideas are not patentable subject matter. If you're pitching an idea to one of your friends, you're not going to be able to claim protection over that idea unless you take certain additional legal steps. So if you got an invention and you're really wanting to go forward with it, keep it to yourself at first, unless you can get the proper legal protections in place to prevent other people from disclosing it. Now, within the last, I'd say, 10 years, there has been a flood of what they call business process patents and software patents. This began really starting about 2010 to where the patent office started granting patents on a way to do business. And all of a sudden, everyone was running to the patent office to get these patents on a particular way to do business. Well, recently, within the last couple years, the validity of these business patents has been challenged significantly, meaning that the Supreme Court and their lower courts have found that these business process patents are invalid and not enforceable. And here's the problem with patents. You can go and you get the patent all the way through the patent office, and when the rubber meets the road to find out whether or not it's enforceable, you won't find out until you're in the middle of litigation. And that can be a very expensive process. With regards to the software patents, those have been coming under scrutiny as well. In 2014, the Supreme Court issued a decision basically striking down a software patent, holding that it's merely an abstract idea. So algorithms or just general ways that computers operate, that is not a patentable subject matter. You have to really delve down into the specifics of the software in order to obtain a patent on the software. It's not completely prohibited, but you can no longer just allege your patent claims, the portions of the product or software in which you're claiming protection, in like a general sense. It has to be very, very specific. And hence, a lot of software patents are being denied by the patent office or being invalidated by courts. So now, what happens once you get your patent? What do you get to do with it? Yeah?
I got a question. A few years ago, I know that there were some lawyers, particularly in the estate planning area, who were trying to patent particular estate planning strategies under the Internal Revenue Code.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we do the trust this way or we do the trust that way, and all tax planners do this with all tax codes. Is that the kind of business process patent? Is that a kind of a business process patent that might not be valid anymore? Because I couldn't figure out how you could patent a particular way to do the Internal Revenue Code just because one lawyer thought it up first. It doesn't mean that there's not some guy in California thinking exactly the same thoughts at exactly the same time.
That
completely independent.
Right. Well, the whole independent creation doesn't really make a difference in patent. That's more of a copyright type of deal because usually it's the first to invent it and file gets the superior rights. So even though you may have thought of it and you may have reduced it to practice, nowadays that person that goes into the patent office and gets that patent, yeah. But what you just explained, being able to do a tax strategy according to the IRS code, you know, the Supreme Court has not outlined exactly what it considers not to be a patentable business process. However, the trend is that there has to be some type of software incorporated that actually executes that business process. And then by doing so, you're going to have to go ahead and meet the requirements for the software patent, meaning you have to be very specific. And it can't be merely an abstract type of idea in order to get that business patent to go through. So, I mean, that's pretty much the way that business process patents are being treated nowadays. But once you get the patent, you mark your product, and what does that mean? That means that no one else can use it, all right? So what else someone else starts using it? Well, you file a patent infringement action. So it means a patent infringement action is essentially someone else is using the same or similar product and contains components that are same or similar to the claims in your patent application. And of course, you can obtain damages for that, etc. But patent litigation is very expensive. Everyday issues. Now, this is what I encounter on a frequent basis. Do you patent or not patent? Well, that's a good question. Because if you remember, patents are only good for so many years. I mean, we all see pharmaceuticals. You go into the CVS, and they ask you, do you want the brand name or do you want the generic? He goes, well, what's a generic? $5. What's a brand name? $40. Yeah, I'll take the generic. Well, the patent's expired on that drug. So now the pharmaceutical companies can't charge, they can't prohibit others from entering the market. They no longer enjoy the ability to charge that $40 per pop for that prescription. So why obtain a patent? Well, think about it. It gives you the exclusive rights, and you can go ahead and license it to others. It also gives you tangible ownership. Now, if your product can be easily reverse engineered, then patent may be the way you want to go, because you run the risk of a competitor coming in, reverse engineering your invention, and then running with it if you don't have a patent on it. Likewise, some people just obtain patents out of a strategy. It's a game. It's beat the other person to the office to prevent them from being able to get a patent on it in order to give yourself a competitive advantage. Will you ever use a patent? Maybe not. Maybe it gets shelved and just sits there and collects dust for the next 21 years. But that is one strategy. Another strategy that's been going on for a couple years is you've seen a lot of firms start gathering multiple patents and what they're called is patent trolls. So they gather this whole portfolio of patents and then they just go out looking to sue people. And that's the way they make money. On the other hand, maybe patent's not the best way to protect your invention. Does anyone know about the Coca-Cola secret formula? Okay, Coca-Cola has a secret formula. Right. You think it's patented?
Trademark.
All right. Well, let's think about it. So they start this secret formula back in the 1900s, right? 1880s. And so in order to get a patent, they have to disclose that secret formula in their patent application so that when the patent expires, then anyone who's skilled in the practice can go ahead and make that secret formula. You know anyone who's making the secret formula nowadays? No. Because they ain't patented. What they did is they kept it as a trade secret instead. And we'll go into that, but a trade secret is certain information that has tremendous economic benefit to a corporation, and they go through great steps in order to prevent that trade secret from being disclosed to others. Another issue that frequently occurs in patents are shop rights or ownership issues. So let's say if you have an employee who's working for you, and you're paying them out, every week, W-2 employee, making not a bad wage, and he comes up with an invention, or she comes up with an invention. There is an issue as to, well, who owns what in that invention? You can remedy some of those issues in the front end if you have them sign certain documents to transfer all inventions and all rights to inventions to the employer. But otherwise, in some instances, the employee ends up being a co-owner. And that could be a huge mistake for companies, especially when the invention has significant economic value to the company, or the company invested significant R&D in coming up with that invention. Well, this is what I'm more practicing every day: trademark, copyrights, trade secrets. A trademark is a source identifier, all right? So source identifier, let's see here, I got my phone somewhere, is the Apple symbol. Okay, that's a logo. Everyone knows what it is, right? You look at it, okay, it's an Apple, but you immediately identify it with Apple computers. That's what they call a design mark. Now here is what a federal trademark registration looks like. The federal trademarks are all registered with the United States Patent and Trademark Office. It's at www.uspto.gov. So you can go on there and you can search the entire database for trademarks that have been registered, pending applications, trademarks that have died or expired, and trademarks that have been denied. And this is a valuable resource in deciding how to go ahead and select what trademark you want to use. Now, in the United States, we have a dual trademark system. There is the federal, and then there's the state system. And then finally, that's for registrations. And then there's common law. So for instance, if I started using a trademark for my business called, let's say, disclosure, I have common law rights in that mark. I didn't go to seek to register it anywhere, didn't pay any filing fees, but that's all right, because under the common law in the United States, I can go ahead and enjoy exclusive use of that mark, meaning that no one else can use the same or similar mark that is likely to be confused with my use. Now, the problems with common law is that your zone of use is usually limited. So what's going to happen is, if you ever get in a fight with someone over the use of the name, they're going to take a look to see where you're doing business and what your foreseeable zone of expansion is going to be. And that could be limited in some cases. So for instance, you have a grocery store. Grocery store is only going to draw people from maybe 10, anywhere from 5 to 10 miles out. So that would be their zone of expansion. And that's where they enjoy trademark rights. Now, someone could open a grocery store, let's say in Hillsborough, using the same name disclosure, and then open the same type of store over in, let's say, Tallahassee, using the same exact name. If I just have common law rights, more generally than not, I'm going to have difficulty trying to prevent that other person in Tallahassee from using my mark. So then, what you have to consider when you're starting your business up is, well, how do I increase my protection? And one of the ways you can do it, which is a relatively inexpensive way if you're staying within the state of Florida, is to file a state trademark application. They're about $80. You can file them online. And that gives you protection throughout the state of Florida for the name that you select. And we'll go in the second half after the break as to how to select a name and what processes you have to go through in order to do that so you don't get yourself in trouble when you're initially starting out. But a Florida state trademark registration will go ahead and give you protection throughout the state of Florida. Now, if you want something that gives you national protection, that would be the federal trademark registration. And the federal trademark registration applies through all the 50 states. So that means that once I obtain that registration, that another person is not going to be able to obtain a registration for the same or similar mark on the USPTO website or on the database. It also means that if we have that scenario where we just discussed, where let's say I own a grocery store in Hillsborough under the name Disclosure, and there's another grocery store out in, let's say, San Francisco that's also operating Disclosure, now that gives me some footing to go ahead and prevent that other person from using that trademark out there for the same types of goods and services. Now, trademark registration, you can apply for it right at sumbiz.gov, okay? And you can search all the trademark registrations there too. Sumbiz.gov is a wealth of information. It gives you the ability to search for businesses, what businesses exist. Gives you ability to search for fictitious names. Now, a fictitious name is when a business would be named, let's say, Zachary Messa, Inc., and I'm doing business as Disclosure. So you're holding yourself out to the public as Disclosure, but the name of your real corporation is Zachary Messa, Inc. Now, this is an example of a state trademark registration. Like I said, you can get them for relatively little cost. The only requirement on this state trademark registration is that you actually have to be using the mark at the time that you apply for it. Okay? So you need to be using it in some form or fashion. Now, if you're using it as a trademark and you're affixing it to a good, then you can go ahead and use a snapshot of the trademark actually affixed to the good, or if it has a hand tag or the packaging. If you're using it as a service mark, meaning that you're only offering services, let's say in brokerage services or whatnot, then your use would begin when you're in your marketing and your advertising materials, where you're using that mark and explaining to the people the services that you offer. Now, there are several different types of trademarks. You have the word mark, design, scent, which a lot of people don't know. There's only like about 6 scent marks out there. Has anyone heard of a scent mark? No? Okay, does anyone have an idea what you think it actually is? No, it can't be. It's not a perfume. Can't be a perfume. It has to be a source identifier. It has to be something to where, you ever had that feeling when you go into a store or a shop and you smell something? There you go. Okay, if they actually pump it in. But you smell something that kind of creates an association with that store or shop. Now, Bed Bath & Beyond. I always think of it as, and forgive me, I go to Las Vegas. I like to go to the Aria Casino. They pump something into that casino that immediately, once I even walk within 100 yards of it, I immediately know exactly where I am. And that is something to where you can smell it and you immediately identify it with a source. That's a scent. That's a scent mark. Now, scent marks are difficult to get because it can't just be a byproduct of the actual product itself, such as perfume or cologne or things like cinnamon. Yeah, it can't be just a scent of a cinnamon. So those are difficult to get there, but there are about a half a dozen of them out there, or maybe a little bit more of that now. There's sound marks as well. You can actually trademark a sound mark. Some of them, such as MGM has them, ESPN, okay, that's a trademark. And the reason why it's a trademark and rather just not a regular riff or something to that extent is because when you hear that, you immediately know it's ESPN. You don't even have to look at the television, okay? And that's the source identifier. And then finally, you have trade dress. Now, trade dress is a particular layout, a decor of an establishment or a product. So, for instance, McDonald's. If McDonald's didn't have the big golden arches on it, would you identify the building as being a McDonald's? Right? Well, the fact that you identified it as being McDonald's is because McDonald's has a certain type of trade dress. They lay out all of their restaurants in a very similar manner, using the same type of color schemes, using the same type of fixtures, etc., to where you can go into a McDonald's here in Hillsboro, or you can go into McDonald's here in Pinellas, you'd still recognize it as McDonald's even without all of the branding. That's a trade dress, because now you recognize that, okay, I'm entering into a McDonald's now rather than some type of other restaurant. So within them, I think we just discussed a word mark. And a word mark would be University of Miami. It's registered. So you're just claiming rights over the word itself. It can be in any design that you want. It can be in any font that you want, any color that you want to use it in. But essentially, you're claiming exclusive rights over that word mark for particular goods or services. Now, in the trademark office, there's about 45 different types of categories of goods and services. So when you go to file for your trademark application, they want you to identify what you're going to be using that mark on. So when you identify that, then you get your registration, then ultimately you'll have protection on using it on over those goods and services, such as education, or on any type of related goods, possibly textbooks or something that would be associated with education.
You can still use, when they have you check it, you use it for more than one, because the education, the sports, right?
Well, you would have, I would argue, that University of Miami would also, a related aspect of that would be sports as well, okay? But what the trademark office usually requires you to do is to select each one of those categories that you want that protection over, okay?
Zach?
Yeah.
It would have to be in that order, so that Miami University, which is in Ohio, is perfectly all right having
Correct.
A trademark for Miami University. And what do you do with organizations, and I'm thinking of colleges off the top of my head, but organizations that have the same name? I mean, there must be four Loyolas.
Right.
Okay, and there's got to be two Xaviers.
The question is whether or not they sought registration. So if you have two Loyolas, it could be in opposite sides of the country.
One in Chicago and one in
New Orleans. Okay. So you have two Loyolas. Each Loyola will not get a trademark, a registered trademark. Okay. So it's one or the other. And you have to make a strategy call as to whether or not it's even worth it at that time, considering that you're not going to enjoy exclusive rights over that mark.
Loyolas, they're all Catholic schools, so
right.
They all report up to the same guy. He's okay with it.
Now there's a design mark or a logo mark. I always like this one to you. They have that for athletics as well. And what you're doing is when you register for this mark, you're saying, I'm just claiming the rights in the design. Now remember earlier we discussed the Coca-Cola bottle? Well, trademarks don't expire like patents. So what Coca-Cola did is they went ahead and registered the design as a distinctive feature of their bottle. And now they have a trademark in it, and that doesn't expire as long as they keep on renewing it every so many years with the trademark office. When you claim a design, you have the option of doing it in color or just black and white, meaning that you could select whatever color that you want to use. Now, Coca-Cola has a color trademark called Red 57. I think it's Red 57. It's a red color. Yeah. Yeah, it's a red color, the Coca-Cola red. So they have exclusive rights over that Coca-Cola red color. Now there are sound marks as well, as we discussed, and let's see if I can get this one to work. Oh, I like this one better.
It may not play.
No.
Hit the press play. When it comes out.
Oh, I can see it right here. There you go.
Okay, problem.
All right, how many movies have we seen? It's MGM, right? So they have the sound mark over that. It's kind of cheat here because you already see what they are.
You've got mail.
All right, there's one. And finally. So those are various types of sound marks that act as a source identifier, and you can go ahead and file and get protection with the United States Patent and Trademark Office with those.
Is the NFL sound right, like, dun, 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 dun.
I haven't looked to see if that one is, but it may very well be. Yeah.
I would think it would be.
Because when you hear that, you know exactly
right?
It's football time.
So usually if remember, you don't have to have it registered to have trademark rights in it. So they may still be able to just say, yes, I do have a trademark in it. It may not be registered, so you can't use it.
How are people supposed to know, like, you know, in like logos and designs, you can put the trademark logo or the copyright,
mm-hmm.
or the copyright sign or the trademark sign next to it, but for sound, so people know that this is a trademark, right? That's the purpose of that?
Well, usually yes. So when you see the little R with the circle in it, that means that that's strictly reserved for federal trademarks, okay? So you can't put that R in a circle next to that trademark until it's been granted by the trademark office. People who use it at common law or are awaiting their trademark registration, they use the TM. Okay? With the sound marks, you're right. No, there's nothing visually that you can see on it. But that's not a defense to copying someone else's trademark just because it doesn't have a TM or a C on it.
And that includes designs and stuff as well.
That's correct.
Okay.
All right. And we'll get to this in copyright, but
let me just explain.
Whenever you're creating a design, you can use
other sources for inspiration,
but never rely on just one source.
Because then you're opening yourself up to some claims for
copyright infringement,
which are so easy nowadays to fall into, especially in light of the internet, with all the images that are out there.
Yeah.
Now, there's the programs that are out there that allow you to take photographs and turn them into illustrations.
Mm-hmm.
And they have little notes on them. They like to put their own name that is created with this program. Do they have any rights to, like, I take the picture, but I want to turn it into an illustration. Do they have any rights to that? Just because they're trying to put their name on it for my photo?
Well, wait, so what you're explaining to me is that you upload the photo to this program and this program turns it into another type of illustration.
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting question as to whether or not, but I would still say you're the author of the photo,
mm-hmm.
and the illustration is what they call a derivative work of your photo.
Mm-hmm.
And as the author, you're the sole person that gets to control your derivative works.
Okay. So.
Okay.
I'm not aware of that program, so that's pretty neat. But yeah. Trademark clearance. This is a process that you go through
before you
begin using a mark. And we're going to reserve that for the later, after the break, because that's a real-world scenario that will apply to your not-for-profits
that you're working on
right now, as to how to go ahead and select a trademark, clear it, and then be confident that your use of the trademark will not step on someone else's toes and cause you to be subject to any type of liability. So with the everyday issues, like I said, I'm going to come back to why do I need to clear a trademark and do I need to register a trademark as well as the state versus federal. But the question is, can I use another person's trademark? Usually no. Strongly recommend against it because that person has exclusive rights for the goods or services in which it's being used. However, there are certain instances to where you can use another person's trademark, and it's called fair use. So for instance, I'm selling computers, right? I have my website set up, and I want to describe the type of computers that I'm selling. Well, I'm selling Apple computers. Well, Apple is a trademark owned by Apple, but it is necessary to use in order to describe the goods or services that I'm offering. So that would be what they call as nominative fair use. And it's just a necessity to use that person's trademark in order to describe the product. Now there's a question as to, well, how much can I use? Generally, you can just use the word mark. Once you start going off and using logos or design marks, then you're treading on thin ice because it's not really necessary to use the Nike swoosh symbol in order to describe the product when you can just use the term Nike. And then finally, how are trademarks enforced? They're enforced through trademark litigation. They're enforced through cease and desist letters to where a trademark owner will send a letter to another party and tell them, hey, stop using my mark because I own superior rights in it. And by the way, maybe pay me some money as well for your unauthorized use. It's also, like I said before, through trademark infringement litigation. And then finally, you can take some steps with the trademark office to cancel other people's marks that have been registered, provided that you do it within a certain time frame from registration. Now, the benefits of registration, you get to put the R symbol on it. And that's valuable because that's a tangible benefit. That's, you know, you have a trademark registration, it goes on your balance sheet, it adds value to your company. The R communicates to everyone that, hey, I have national rights in this trademark and not just any type of local rights or just state rights. You have the right to sue in federal court. There are two levels of courts in the United States. And did you already cover this? Okay. So you have the right to sue in federal court rather than just state court.
You also have statutory damages in the event there is counterfeiting. And interestingly enough, you can actually use U.S. Customs and Border Patrol to help enforce your mark.
Because how many people have found counterfeit goods?
Okay. The Louis Vuitton bag for $25 is not an original, okay? You go to Canal Street in New York, and they're flooding the market. So what happens is a company such as Louis Vuitton can go ahead and say to U.S. Customs, hey, I have a federally registered trademark for Louis Vuitton. It could be the LV. It could be the designs that are on the bag. And they give that to the Customs, and Customs can actually seize counterfeit goods as they're coming in. And they would never even enter the United States. That's very powerful because when these counterfeit goods come in, they don't come in little small quantities, dribs and drabs. They're pretty large shipments. And when you tell the person who's supposed to be receiving the shipment that you're not getting your goods, we're confiscating them, we're going to destroy them, and on top of that, you're going to have to pay a fine, that's a very powerful tool. However, let's face it. Trademark enforcement for the Customs and Border Patrol isn't at the highest priority. They have much more important things to do. So the level of intensity or the likelihood that they're going to go through every single shipment to check it against trademarks is not as significant. So that's why it's incumbent upon the trademark owner or the brand owner to be vigilant about it with the Customs. Then it also provides a basis for foreign registrations. Now, we've just been talking about the United States, but we all know that, you know, we're just one country in this whole world.
And this is really an economic,
this is a real global economy. So what I have been found is that a lot of my clients, they want to start going beyond the borders of the United States.
And they want to see,
well, you know, can I get a trademark in the European Union? Can I get a trademark in New Zealand, et cetera? Well, what the federal trademark registration does, it provides a platform
that other countries recognize,
in some cases, such as the EU, to where you can go ahead and file those applications.
For the trademarks in the Europe, would you go to the European Union and file them, or would you go to the selected country?
No, there's two ways you can file them. Okay, they have a CTM, which is called a community trademark, and that mark is filed, covers all the EU countries. Okay, and what it does is it's like a central filing system, making it very easy to go ahead and file in one place to cover all these countries. Now, anyone in any of those countries have the opportunity to object to the registration of that mark. For various grounds. They could say the mark is too close to something I'm already using, or I was using that mark before you're using it. If that occurs, well then it gets kicked out and you have to seek an alternative method, which I'll tell you in a second. But if it doesn't occur and the registration goes through, then you're covered in all of the European country, all the EU countries, okay? If it gets kicked out, then you have to go along the lines of what they call an international registration. And that's a little bit different. That's where you go ahead and seek registration in each individual country. And that is usually a cost prohibitive method of getting a trademark registration over in the EU because it's very expensive. I mean, if you want to do every single country in the EU, you're looking at thousands and thousands of dollars, as opposed to just being able to file one trademark application in a centralized location. So, yeah?
So how do you protect yourself under other countries if you just file in the United States and you don't want your product anywhere else?
Okay. Well, one of the ways that you protect yourself in the country is that you're now, you know, laying down the law saying that I'm the only person in this country that can use this mark on these types of goods and services. So if another person seeks to go ahead and import other, you know, goods or services under the same mark, well, then you have an potential action against that other person. Or as we discussed before, if, you know, they bring in these other goods on the mark and they're using your trademark on them, then you can take action with customs to have them seize it as well. They could, yeah, they could still, because you're limited to the U.S. Mm-hmm. Now, just to give you an idea of
how significant, let's say, trademark
or brand value is, I mean, Apple's brand value is $145 billion. That's pretty significant. I think that's, what, equal to Donald Trump's net worth? But,
no, that's what he tells you his net worth.
Yeah, okay. And then trailing behind Apple is Google, McDonald's, BMW, and Walt Disney. So you can see how important Apple believes that its brand
value is, considering that it generates
it has a value of $145 billion. George?
I got a couple questions. Looking at Apple, help me understand, you've got Apple Computer and Apple Records.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, both use an Apple, both have Apple, but yet they seem to peacefully coexist. They may have settled this lawsuit a long time ago. But Apple Records, Apple Computer, two different businesses, similar name. What if my name is McDonald and I want to open a restaurant?
Called McDonald's?
Yeah. Or what if I'm Idaho Building Materials, and I want to have a trademark that says IBM?
Okay.
Well, let's start off with your McDonald's scenario.
You can go ahead and open your restaurant.
Can I get a love letter from the lawyers?
You'll probably get a love letter, but
you won't be able to get a trademark registration on it. Okay, because McDonald's has that all blocked, all cornered on the
trademark registry.
As to your
Apple example, we have Apple Records and Apple
Computers. How long ago was that?
Well, that's Apple been a, Records they've been, was the Beatles, so it was like 67, 68.
Right. So
Steve Jobs was in high school.
Right. So at the point in time to where you had Apple Records and Apple Computers, I mean, who would have thought 30 years ago that computers would have anything to do with music? Nowadays, that could be quite a different scenario. But back then, you have two companies that may be using two of the same names, but offering goods or services, offering different goods or services. So the question is, what's the likelihood of confusion among the customers? Is there a likelihood of confusion among source, sponsorship, or affiliation? Now, they could have come to an agreement, I don't know, what they call a coexistence agreement. And what that means that, let's say if one party is upset about your use of a certain mark, and they're just kind of flexing their muscles to see, you know, if they can get you to stop using it, or to kind of box you in, or to prevent you from expanding into an area which they may be wanting to expand into. You can enter into what they call a coexistence agreement. And that's a written document to where basically each of the parties agree to get along. You peacefully coexist. You just say, okay, look, I'm going to use mine for my Apple Records and production, and you're going to use yours for computers. Okay, we're good with that. And each of the parties operate in the marketplace under those scenarios. They can get more complicated if
there are certain areas of
what they call actual confusion among customers arise. So let's
say if a customer was calling up
Apple Music saying, now look, I really want to buy your new iPad. Okay, well, that's what they call actual confusion. That's the strongest factor in this likelihood of confusion analysis. Well, a coexistence agreement may say, hey, if that ever occurs, then, you know, could you just, you know, state this certain language? No, we're not Apple, you know, we're not Apple Records, or we're not Apple Computers. You know, you need to contact so-and-so. So that's a way to quell that confusion.
There's a
variety of different ways that you can skin this cat. The question is,
how cooperative the person on the other side going to be, or are they
very litigious and they just want to try to go ahead and take it to court
in order to, I guess, enforce or
show how strong their mark actually is.
Does, like Pandora Music and Pandora Jewelry, do they
two
do
different
the same
things.
Thing? Because if you look them up, if you type in Pandora, mm-hmm. one or the other comes up.
Right, you don't have to, under that scenario, I mean, if I'm Pandora Jewelry and you have Pandora Music, two completely different classes. Remember when I talked earlier about the trademark registry? It has like about 40 plus different types of classes. When you select those, as long as you can have two identical marks on the registry, as long as the goods of those marks are not the same, similar, or related. So you here have, one, you have a jewelry company for Pandora Jewelry, and two, you have a music company for Pandora. Those marks are not related. There's not similar goods or services. So it really shouldn't be an issue with those.
The other question I had has to do with trademarking common words. I know Coca-Cola, we've been talking about Coca a lot. Coca-Cola is trying to get a trademark for the word
zero.
Right, they want Coke Zero, Coca-Cola. They don't want to ever see Pepsi Zero.
And I think they should get it.
And so I was wondering, because they hadn't been able to do Diet, right? There's
no.
Diet Coke, Diet Pepsi, Diet everything else. And they weren't able to do it with Light, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's Miller Light, Bud Light, Corona Light, every kind of a beer that has a light version, there's a light of it.
Right.
So, well, what about that, and can Coke have zero and nobody else can? Or is it just the way they express zero? You know,
no.
A certain style of font or something.
That's
like that.
One way they can do it, but let me explain to you. In order, a merely descriptive mark is not registrable. So Idaho Potatoes for Idaho Potatoes, I'm not going to get a registration from that because it merely describes the goods or services or characteristic thereof. Okay. Now, there are instances to where you can be using a descriptive mark for a number of years, and that mark has taken on a life of its own. And what I mean by that is, in the mind of the consumer, it's no longer just a description, but it's an actual source identifier. That's what they called acquired distinctiveness. So now you have taken what is originally an unregisterable descriptive mark and transformed it into a registrable mark. And the way that they do that is through years of use, basically advertising expenditures, and they really focus in on what have you done to educate the public and convince the public that the mark no longer simply describes the goods that you're offering. Now, the zero scenario, they've been using that for I don't know how many years, but I know that they have invested a significant amount of money.
2009.
Okay.
I work for Coke.
Okay, you work for Coke.
That's
why. I was like, how did you know? But anyways.
All right, so what's your advertising in the last 6 years?
The benchmark is usually about 5 years, and that's when you can start trying to make a claim that there's this acquired distinctiveness or secondary meaning, and you have to do that through various different types of avenues. For instance, you can get customer statements as to, you know, I believe this is associated with your mark. You can do it. In addition to that, you can use your sales revenues, your advertising expenditures, the outlets that you use to advertise. All of that is all evidence that's used to determine whether or not you have now transcended the merely descriptive into now being a source identifier. So, I mean, I think when you see Coke, I mean, the only product that I think of when I hear zero is a Coca-Cola product.
Is that kind of like, if you say Q-tip, you're really thinking of a cotton swab, or say Clorox, you're really thinking of bleach, or Band-Aid, you're really thinking of a bandage? Is that kind of the same thing?
Well, you're doing it in a little bit different scenario, okay?
Yeah, that's backwards.
That's backwards, but that's interesting. That's a really important, that's an important topic, because generic marks, Band-Aid, or not Band-Aid, bandage, I can't get a trademark for a generic mark, okay? Potato, you're not gonna get a trademark for potato, for selling potatoes. I don't care how long you're using and how much money you spent in it. But what it does happen is that's called a generic mark, and it will never transcend to secondary meaning. But you have, now what you just described is you have a situation to where Band-Aid or Xerox or Photoshop,
Kleenex,
these are, we're all registered marks. And what happened is people start using them to refer to just any type of tissue. Or, yeah, I'm going to Photoshop that, meaning I want to alter that picture. Or I want to make a Xerox,
which is, I'm going to make a copy rather than actually using a Xerox machine.
What that is, that's called a mark that's starting to become generic. Okay, so it's had trademark rights into it because it was a source identifier, but now through continued uninhibited use of the mark in an adverse way, now it's starting to become generic. So what a company does when they encounter that situation is they go on to a blitz and they start to try to re-educate the product, re-teach the consumer that Kleenex refers to, you know, is an actual brand rather than just a tissue, or Xerox is an actual brand rather than a tissue. Because if they just sit back and let it ride, then all of their rights are going to erode away and they're not going to have any more trademark rights in that mark. Good question. There you go. On me. Excellent. Yeah. All right, so we're at 8 o'clock. Is this when you guys usually take a break?
Yeah, anywhere now in the next 15 minutes. If now is a good time for you, that's fine.
Well, we'll just finish through the basics with copyright, and then we can go into some real world scenarios with your not-for-profits. Now, copyright. Copyright is different from trademark and patents. Copyright doesn't grant you any type of monopoly over the copyright work. What it grants you is the exclusive right to either make a copy of, make a derivative, which is use that original work to make, you know, some type of an extension of it. It gives you the right to publicly display, and then basically those are the primary types of protections under copyright.
So for instance,
what is entitled to copyright protection? Copyright protection is the moment that you fix the original work in a tangible medium. Tangible medium could be digital, it could be sitting here on a piece of paper. Copyright protection extends to whether or not you obtain a registration or do not obtain a registration. That's not necessary. So for instance, you have an artist to sitting there and he's playing a riff and he's recording it. Well, that artist, once he records it in a tangible medium, he's the author, the creator of that copyrighted work. Likewise, an author can create, or a musician can create copyrighted work by making sheet music. So he writes out his sheet music. That's copyrighted work. Or, in the text scenario, the lyrics to the song. He writes down the lyrics to the song. That would be a copyrighted work as well. So he would enjoy those exclusive rights in that work. Now, one of the pole stars is that it has to be original. Now, original doesn't mean novel, like patent. That means that create a copyrighted work and to obtain protection over it, it doesn't have to be something completely new. Just it has to have a little hint of creativity. And once it has that, which is a very, very low threshold, then it meets the originality standards. What you can't do is you just can't copy from someone else in order to create the work, because it would not be considered an original work at that point in time. The copyright notice.
The little C symbol, you can attach it on your work whether or not you have a copyright registration or not. Makes no difference. You don't have to register a copyright with the Copyright Office.
So you can put the C. Or the word copyright.
Or the abbreviation COPR, which I have never seen.
Along with the publication year, date, and your name. So you see in the bottom,
I have like the copyright
symbol 2015, Zachary Messa. So that's how you do a copyright notice. And copyright notices are no longer mandatory, meaning that before, back in the 80s, you didn't put the copyright notice on the work,
then you're saying that the work goes into the public domain.
And what I mean by the public domain
is that it's out for everyone to use freely as they wish,
which a lot of people think that's what the internet is. Okay. but that is not the case. Now, the benefits of a copyright registration, whether it be, whether you're a musician, you're an artist, a fine artist, you're a novelist, whatever you create, graphic artist, the benefits are is that if there is an infringement and you're already registered,
meaning that someone has
copied your work and the two works are substantially similar, if that occurs and you already have a copyright registration, then you're entitled to some presumed damages. And the presumed damages are up to $150,000. Those are called statutory damages. In addition, you have the right to recover your attorney's, or not the right, you have the ability to ask for the recovery of your attorney's fees and costs. And that can be quite expensive, considering that copyright infringement matters are litigated exclusively in federal court. Federal court is expensive. No way around it. And when you have the ability to use that attorney's fees provision as leverage, it really creates a game changer and gives you a certain dynamic to your case that really pressures the other side to do the right thing. The duration of a copyright is the life of the author plus 70 years. Good luck on trying to figure that out by just looking at the copyrighted work. That takes extensive research in order to determine whether or not copyright still remains valid.
What happened with Happy Birthday?
Happy Birthday. There we go. I was waiting for that
just
one.
Just in the news.
Happy Birthday, sure. Happy Birthday. Everyone knows Happy Birthday, right? Do you remember? I remember growing up, everyone used to sing Happy Birthday at all the chain restaurants, right? They come out, sing Happy Birthday, bring you a little cake, right?
Yeah, public humiliation ceremony.
There you go. So everyone gathers around. Well, then over the years, you notice that they weren't singing Happy Birthday anymore. They were singing some type of derivation for the song, whatever it may be. So that was kind of interesting, I thought. So turns out that Time Warner claimed all the rights in Happy Birthday. And more specifically, they claimed all the performance rights. So what that means is that no one can go ahead and perform Happy Birthday publicly
unless they have the right to do so or license
from Time Warner. So for years, Time Warner was issuing these licenses, realizing a nice revenue stream from it,
until a plaintiff brought a class action
lawsuit challenging their rights to the copyrighted song as to whether or not they had ownership rights or if it entered into the public domain. Ultimately, the plaintiffs prevailed, and Time Warner's ownership of the Happy Birthday song has now since passed because the copyright has, expired.
Yeah. There's a tribute that the story I got was that the song is attributed to a woman from the 19th century, late 19th century, who wrote it for her, she was like a nanny or something like that, the 1890s equivalent of a daycare provider. And it was supposed to be some little song that she sang to them that had nothing to do with Happy Birthday, and the tune had everything to do with getting them to come to a meal or something like that. Instead of sit down and have lunch, you know.
And it spun out of control from
there. Yeah, yeah.
I can't remember off the top of my head if it was invalidated because of the expiration or because they didn't have ownership rights over it. I don't recall. But at the end of the day, they no longer have the right to go ahead and license out Happy Birthday.
So you can go to a restaurant now and
hopefully we'll see.
With
yeah.
Actually happy with Happy Birthday.
And embarrass you. Yeah, absolutely. There's a little bit different scenario when the copyrighted work is a work for hire. Now, a work for hire,
essentially, let's say, for instance, you have an
employee that during the course of their employment creates copyrighted work. So you are an advertising firm who employs graphic designers. And part of their job responsibilities is to go ahead and create, you know, graphic designs. Since that employee is created during the scope of their work, the employer or the business actually owns that copyright. So therefore, there's a longer duration of those type of copyrights when it's originally owned by the employer. Now, a copyright provides no protection over ideas, procedures, processes, systems, methods, concepts, etc. All right, it's just solely protects your original expression in the work. So for instance, I'm sitting here right now, I sketch the, a landscape scene of a nice sunset over the Gulf. Another guy over in California decides that he wants to go down to the Pacific Ocean and also do the same thing. The two paintings are identical, all right? There's no copyright infringement there. That's what they call independent creation. Because he didn't copy from my work, he created it himself. We just had similar modes of expression. So if there's no copying, then there is no infringement. So that's, whenever you're creating something, the best thing that you can always do is start from scratch. Because if you start from scratch, and no one can come after you and claim that you copied my work, especially if you have your original sketches, etc. Once a work life expires, it goes into the public domain. Like I said earlier, before 1989, if you didn't attach the copyright notice to the work, in certain instances it went to the public domain. Any type of work that's authored by the U.S. government is also in the public domain. And what that means, public domain, it means it's right for everyone to go ahead and use.
So nobody's sending Mozart's estate a check every time they perform?
No. No, I don't think Mozart's estate enjoys that luxury anymore.
No wonder they now publish Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies.
There you go. Pride, Prejudice, Zombies, with the Brothers Grimm.
I think that's another one that's in the public domain. It's the Snow White story.
Yeah.
So that's why you see a bunch of different
movies being made off of it. But interestingly enough, though, if something's in the public domain and you let's say it's a novel and you make a movie off it, you still have original protectable aspects in that movie that have not entered into the public domain.
Just ask Disney.
Yeah, exactly. So then the final portion of the copyright is clearance. And we're going to reserve that for when we talk about your startup companies. All right, so you all turn in your, I guess, your preliminary papers and your not-for-profits? Or?
Yeah, okay. They're sitting in my to-do list, my to-do pile.
Okay, are they allowed to share what they're doing?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, all right, good deal. All right, so let's talk about some not-for-profits. Anyone want to volunteer what their one of the not-for-profits is going to be? Anyone? Sure.
We're the dads, defending all dads.
Okay.
And we're an organization, an agency that assists fathers with exercising their parental rights to father their children. And we help them from the legitimation process through education, recidivism, make sure that they're not going back in. They were out, had been in jail, with new fathers who, teen fathers who don't know how to parent. We protect them against malicious mother syndrome, parental alienation.
Okay. So. All right, good deal. All right, so what's the name of your not-for-profit?
Dads. Defending all dads.
Defending all dads. Okay, that's interesting. So how did you select the name?
We brainstormed.
You brainstorm. So when you select the name, who's also involved in the project?
Your group.
Okay, your group? Okay. So you came up with an idea, and I guess the content of the idea, the process, right? So applying what we learned today, the likelihood of being able to patent that process would probably not be very significant, low to non-existent at best, okay? So you need to look down at other avenues to try to set yourself apart and distinguish yourself in the marketplace, even though you're not-for-profit, okay? Because not-for-profit doesn't mean no profit, okay? It just means that there's nothing left over at the end of the year. So one of the ways you did that was by selecting your name. All right, so when you selected your name, did you just brainstorm and say, I'm going to use that name?
Yeah, we brainstormed. We're going to use the acronym.
Okay.
It's perfect.
Sure, it is perfect.
It was her idea, actually. She's really good.
All right, so let's take your acronym. So DAD. Now, you're offering these services to dads, but it's almost got a little bit of a hint as to, you got to think about it for a second as to what type of service you're offering, right? So when you have to make that think, that little mental pause, then your mark goes from a merely descriptive mark to what they call a suggestive mark. And it is registrable on the as a trademark at that point in time, and you can claim trademark rights in it. All right? Now, you selected the name, and you're ready to launch your corporation. What's the name of the corp? You got the acronym.
Defending All Dads.
Okay, Defending All Dads, Inc. All right, great. All right. So Defending All Dads, Inc. is going to be your trade name, right? So you go ahead and you go to the Division of Corporations, and you say, okay, we're going to go ahead and file our Articles of Incorporation, and we're going to form our business not-for-profit. I'm doing Defending All Dads, Inc. Great. So now you're going to think, okay, I got Defending All Dads, Inc. As my corporation set up. But I'm going to be known as Dads, not Defending All Dads, Inc. So what do I do next? Well, one of the things you can do for a low cost is to go ahead and get a fictitious name through the corporation. So you'll be doing business as Dads, and then your business name is Defending All Dads, Inc. Now, before you even get to that process, you left off a very crucial step. What if someone down the street is using the same trademark, Defending All Dads? Okay. If you skip the process, what they call trademark clearance, then what you do is you run into the risk of just going right down the line, because generally the state is not going to tell you you can't register a corporation under a name unless it's an identical name of another company. You're not going to get a prohibition on being able to get a fictitious name more generally than not. So these issues don't come up until later on down the line, when you already invested all your money and resources into branding, to getting everything out there. So it's important to do a trademark clearance on the front end. Now, trademark clearances to determine whether or not you can use a potential trademark. The way I start out is do reverse. Select the domain name first.
Make sure the domain name
is available for the mark that you want to use, .com. Because we use so much internet nowadays, if that domain name's not available, then maybe you want to move on for something else. Now, please don't fall into the trap that just because a domain name's available means that you can go ahead and use the mark, okay? I'm not sure if Coca-Cola has every single domain name wrapped up in every single variation. I'm sure close to it. But, I mean, you can go ahead and do some type of variation on Coca-Cola, C-O-K-A-K-O-L-A, get the .com for that, but guess what? That's still very similar, if not identical, to Coca-Cola. It has the same type of sound, same type of visual appearance, and you're going to be getting a letter from Coca-Cola, okay, about abandoning that trade, the domain name, or transferring it to them. So once you identify your domain names, then you want to come up with, you know, obviously about three different or four different names that you really like to use for your business, that you believe really embody or communicate to your consumer what you're all about. Because, you know, developing a brand is not just a name, it's really kind of the essence, the culture behind the brand. That's what people are buying, that intangible. You know, nowadays, you know, you buy a Nike hat, because you recognize that brand, as opposed to another hat that doesn't have on it. You'll more likely than not gravitate towards the Nike hat because you're familiar with it. It's in your mind, you may not realize it or not, but it has a certain level of quality that's associated with it, or what they call in the industry is called goodwill. And when you develop that goodwill in a brand, that becomes a very important and tangible asset for your business. So you select three names, and then, okay, I have three names, what do I do next? Well, you can go right to the trademark office, and you can do a simple search and plug in those three names and see if anything else pops up. If something pops up, then you're going to have to say, well, how similar is it? Are they offering the same type of goods or services that I'm offering? And if they are, then you have to ask yourself, well, do I really want to, you know, start off, you know, already in the hole and potentially get myself into some trouble? Or do I just want to move on at this early stage and select something else? Likewise, it may show that there isn't anything out there. So you go ahead and you run all three or four of those names. And then you rank them in your order of preference. If it stays, great. If it doesn't, then you just cross it off the list and move on. So then you need to determine, okay, well, I've determined these three names. I've done some preliminary clearance on them. Run a Google search. See what pops up. See if anyone out there is offering any types of goods or services under the same name that doesn't have a registered trademark. Okay, because remember, you don't have to register a trademark. It can be used at common law. Now, what I do is I don't have time to do a Google search, and frankly, I don't think it always comes back with the best results. I order a report through Thomson Reuters. This report's about $780. And yep, I know.
Textbooks are expensive.
Yep. But I can tell you this, report buys you a certain level of certainty, and it's like a security blanket. It makes you feel all nice, warm, and fuzzy inside. Because what this report does is this is a complete snapshot of the United States as of the date that I got this report for this mark. Now, this one is Cody's Original Roadhouse. I'm sure you guys know, heard of that. And what it does is it searches all registrations, whether it be federal or state registrations. And it goes to each state's division of corporations and searches to see if there's any fictitious names or if there's any other similar registered corporations. Then what it does, which is the really valuable part, is that it crawls the internet and it will pull out any terms that are the same or similar to the one that I'm seeking to apply. So when I get this report back, I can go ahead and thumb through it or analyze it, and it's going to give me a pretty accurate snapshot of what's going on at this point in time. And then I can use this report to determine whether or not certain marks are available or they're not available, or certain strategies on how to proceed, maybe changing the mark up a little bit to make the likelihood that it'll be registered, not confusing with another mark, more significant. So this is, when you go to an attorney, this is what I usually recommend. Because when you have a report like this in your back pocket, no one can ever say you willfully infringe, because you went through the process with an attorney to try to work it out, and you have some type of legal basis as to why your mark is not infringing upon another's mark. So once you have the, you've done your clearance, you decide to go ahead and launch your brand. All right. Is anyone going to develop a website for the not-for-profit? And no one's going to use a website. Then how are your customers going to contact you? You have to have a website, okay? Has anyone ever developed a website before? Is anyone a business owner? Okay, you have developed a website. Okay. Did you use a website developer?
I did. Okay. Through the company.
Okay, great. So you go through a web, you go and you hire a website developer, and they develop this beautiful website for you, right? And you got all your pictures up, you got all the text just the way you want it, you can navigate through the website, you really like the way it's come out. Now, you notice that about a year from now, you get another letter from your developer, and he says, hey, I need some more money to host your website. And you say, well, I'm not gonna pay that. And then he's gonna say to you, well, I am not going to allow you to use the website anymore. Well, the reason for that is because when you hire another party to create a website, which is considered a copyrighted work, the party who created it is the owner. You just have permission to use that work. So if I hire a photographer, or Q back here is taking this video right here, Q, or I guess he's doing it on behalf of the university, the college, but if Q is making his own video, let's say at my wedding, okay? So he's doing the video for my wedding, and I said, you know, I'd like a copy, Q. And he's like, sure, pay me, Zach. And I said, okay, no problem, here you go. I don't have all rights to that video. I can't go ahead and start splicing that video up and making copies of it and sending it to all my relatives and all that good stuff. Q is the copyright owner of that video. If I want to make additional copies, then I need to go to the copyright owner, the man who shot it, the man who sold the license, the right to use it to me, but not the right to make multiple copies. Now, absent, in order to obtain that right, there needs to be a written agreement. So let's say I sat down before our wedding, and my wife's going, you got to use this guy, you got to use this guy. And I finally sit down with him, and we go over the contract. And the contract says, you are going to be the exclusive owner of all rights in this video. And I'm transferring all those rights to you. Well, that's a different situation, because now I would be considered the copyright owner of the video. Even though I'm not the creator or the author, I am now the owner. So I can do with it whatever I like. Absent that written language, you just have permission to use it. So let's circle around to your website. So now you have another person develop a website for you. They're the owners of that website, and you are not. You just have permission to use. So if you want to alter that website or take it to another developer, technically you're not allowed to do so. More importantly, this issue commonly arises in graphic design. So you have an individual who's a graphic designer, and a business wants to go ahead and develop a logo. Are you going to use a logo for your business? Okay. All right, a lot of people like to use logos. So you go to this graphic designer, and he develops a logo for you. And you're going to use that logo as part of your trademark, maybe a design mark. Well, that graphic artist is still considered the owner of that logo. And what he's doing is he's giving you permission, or owner of that graphic, he's giving you permission to go ahead and use that graphic for your business. Now, that's a slippery slope, because let's say your brand or your service, you knock it out of the park. And all of a sudden, you have customers recognizing you left and right based upon this logo. Well, in the future, if you want to go ahead and sell your company, that purchaser is going to be darn sure that you own all rights to that graphic. And if you're unable to produce that piece of paper, you have to go try to hunt down that graphic artist to try to get him to sign that piece of paper to try transfer those rights to you. And trust me, I've done it. It's not a fun task to do. And usually it costs you quite a bit more on the back end than it is the front end to secure all rights. But since you are a startup, you need to be aware of these situations, because there may be instances where you can't afford the copyright, you can't afford the ownership. Because when you're asking for them to transfer those types of rights to you, they're going to want an increased price. It's going to cost you more. So that is the trade-off. And as long as you know that that trade-off is there, that's half the battle. So remember, if you don't have a written agreement with a non-W-2 employee that makes any work for you, then you don't own that work. You have the right to use that work. All right. So now we've gone to developing your website. So now the next thing is, anyone put any thought into hiring employees? Yeah. Anyone? Yeah. How many employees are you going to have?
Six.
You're going to have six. Okay. So you're going to have six employees that come to work for you. And what are they going to be doing for you?
Three of them are doing data entry and stuff like that.
Okay.
Three other ones are going to be educated professional counselors.
Very well. Are you going to develop training materials for these employees?
I'm sure we'll have to.
Are your other employees going to develop training manuals as well?
Well, I guess so. We didn't think that far ahead.
Okay. Well, let's say, you know, the employees create a training manual. The question is that within the scope of their employment? Are those employees expected, or would it be a, some type of task that would arise in the course of their employment to create that training manual or the scope of their work? If it does, well, then your business is going to be the owner of that training manual.
Okay. But more importantly, you mentioned that your employees are going to be
data entry and all that other good stuff, right?
Yeah, they'll be doing like the grunt work, I guess you could say.
Okay. And when you enter in all this data, what are you going to, what's going to
be the end product?
Just the data entry. Is it going
to? The information they're entering is for the counselors to use for the charity.
Oh, okay. So is it like health information or?
We're basically helping people find career opportunities, but it's more for people that have a difficult time, such as felons.
Okay. All right, so do you think they may be providing like social security numbers and stuff like that for job applications, especially since they're a felon?
We're going to do drug testing.
Okay. Oh, so you're going to do drug testing as well?
We thought about it, but we're still looking to outsource that.
Okay. Well, are you going to have the results of those drug tests?
I don't think so. Because I think they'll be provided, because they'll be felons. Those will be done, I would assume, by their parole offices.
So you're not going to want to know the results for this?
Whether they're clean or not, I think that's about it.
Okay. All right. So now you described to me some of the information that your employees have access to is some pretty confidential type of information. I mean, especially if they have access to, let's say, Social Security numbers, or even if it's, you know, credit card numbers, or let's say they act, if you have a sales force that has access to a customer list. Now you're probably thinking, well, what if that employee gets up and just walks out with all this information? Does anyone know what you can do to try to prevent that? Anyone? A what? You can do a confidentiality agreement, absolutely. So in the employment agreement with the employee, you can have certain provisions in there that says that you're not going to disclose any information you learn during your employment to anyone else. And usually there's a time frame on that. Because at some point, depending upon the type of confidential information, like social security numbers, health information, the confidentiality on that would never expire. But on some other types of confidential information that's not available, generally available to the public, there's usually some type of useful life on that. So you get them to enter a confidentiality agreement, absolutely. And in some instances, you can even get them to enter what they call a non-compete agreement. And a non-compete says that, oh, wait a minute, you're going to sign this and you're going to read that you're not going to work for a competitor of mine for however many, you know, years. Now, as you start to expand the number of years and the geographic scope of that non-compete, you're going to start bringing the vulnerability of that non-compete into question. Because, hey, everybody needs to make a living. And the courts are going to look at non-competes as, you know, I understand your necessity to protect your business, but at the end of the day, you know, there needs to be some type of reasonable time frame and geographic zone to allow this person to go ahead and make a living doing something else. So now we have confidential information that you're going to be protected, which is also considered a trade secret, especially if you have an economic value to it. Now, the benefits of taking this proactive step to protect this information that you're developing is that that's one of the requirements in order to keep it a trade secret. So, for instance, if Coca-Cola, when they're bottling their Coke, you know, is basically handing out the secret recipe to all their employees who aren't under any confidentiality obligations, etc., saying, you know, this is what needs to be in this, that, and the other in order to put your bottle of Coke together, then there's a high likelihood that their ability to claim any type of trade secret over that information would be significantly diminished.
Because they haven't taken the appropriate steps to guard
against that information from entering the public domain. So now we're to the employee's scenario, to where you hired your employees, you have them under some form of employment agreement that has some type of confidentiality provision designed to protect your intellectual property. You can also include provisions into that saying that if there's any inventions that are made during their employment, that that invention goes to the employer. It's owned by the employer. That's not uncommon either. And that helps you put to rest any issues to where, let's say, if you're being acquired down the line, and you know there is an invention that multiple different employees worked on, and you do not have that that language in your agreement, then there's always a risk by the person buying your company as to, well, what exactly am I getting? Is one of these employees going to come out of the woodwork and claim a partial ownership in this invention? As opposed to if you took care of it on the front end and had it documented and then present that file in your due diligence to your buyer, that gives them a level of comfort that they know exactly what they're getting and that you own, you have the ownership rights in it. So now we progress through to the employment issues. And I guess the next thing is, what do I do with my trademark portfolio? With my portfolio, my intellectual property portfolio. Remember, that can consist of patents, that can be trademarks, that can be copyrights. So do I register, do I not register? Well, you're a startup. You can't go register every single thing that you want to register because you're not going to have the capital, more likely than not. The thing that you have to recognize, though, is you have to recognize when the rights arise to give you the opportunity to register. And then you can make a decision as to whether or not you want to seek to protect that that information through registration. So, for instance, you have trademark and copyright. We know that registration is not absolutely necessary for either one of those. If you're choosing between a trademark or a copyright, maybe you make the educated or business decision that I want to spend my limited sources of funds on gaining that registered trademark because I am going to be selling throughout the United States and I want to prevent others from using that same or similar mark. Because remember, I can use it at common law, but that doesn't prevent someone up, you know, in Georgia from using the same mark in common law as well. But then at the end, in the future, if I want to expand into Georgia and this guy is using the same disclosure mark that I'm using down here in Florida, I'm going to be prohibited from going into his territory because he already has priority in that Georgia market. So think of it as like the red and blue in, you know, in the whole electoral or whole the race with between the Republicans and the Democrats. You know, you can have red marks, red states and blue states, and they start to get populated and filled up. And if you have a common law mark, you may have it in a blue state, but someone else may have it in a red state. And just because you own Florida, the blue state, doesn't mean that you go into Georgia, which is a red state. So that's the types of things that you need to think about when you're expanding your brand. How am I going to do it? What type of channels of trade am I going to use? Are you going to be doing hard copy advertising? Or are you going to be doing digital advertising? Am I going to be using publications that are disseminated over the internet? Or am I going to be more towards a video type of scenario? Everything that needs to be factored into your decision as to how you want to protect your intellectual property. So going to trademarks, or excuse me, to copyrights. Copyrights also experience the same type of level of clearance as trademarks. Now, I know how easy it is to go ahead and right-click and copy on anything you get out of the internet, okay? Right-click, copy, paste, all right, boom. Got your image right there, took a large piece of text, etc. Don't do it. Don't do it. It's a copyright infringement. You don't have, more generally than not, you do not have rights to make copies of that image and use them in your business, for especially for commercial purposes. Because even though you're not for profit, it's still a commercial purpose. So there's two things that can occur. One is you can try to trace back as to who owns the copyrighted image, which is very difficult to do unless the person who posted the image was also the author or the creator of the image and included certain information in the image's metadata, which you can access to find out who's claiming rights in it. Or you can go to a professional and hire them and ask them to create the image themselves, all right, through a graphic artist, photographer, videographer, whatever you may do. Because now you know that you're hiring that person to create a certain image for you that you don't have to worry about getting sideways with the copyright laws. The penalties for the right click and paste are dramatic. If you have someone come after you for copyright infringement and you did copy and paste, more generally than not, they're not very forgiving about it. It's going to cost you, you know, significant sums of money to resolve the situation, which frankly a startup company doesn't have, especially a not-for-profit. So then you're faced with the scenario, before you even get out of the gate, you may have to think about closing your doors because there's no, because this litigation is just going to basically kill your ability to continue to do business. All things to think about. All right, so now we're through the copyright phase. We already did the trade secrets, and there's another thing called, which is not very often mentioned, it's called rights of publicity. Has anyone heard of that? Rights of publicity is the right to use someone's name or likeness. Okay, it can extend to their voice as well. So for instance, I have, let's say, Hulk Hogan comes to one of my open houses for the launching of my new not-for-profit, okay? I, myself, take Hulk Hogan's picture. Now, I am the copyright owner of that picture. I snap that picture off. That's my picture, okay? Hulk Hogan owns the rights to his name or likeness. So I could not go ahead and use that picture and paste it on my website and use that for a commercial purpose in order to promote my goods or services because I don't have his permission. Right? So there's two areas whenever you're looking to use photography, especially of individuals, that you need to focus on. Not just obtaining the rights or the right to use the photograph, but also obtaining the rights or the release from the person inside the photograph who it depicts so that you can use their image. So now I think we've covered the trademark, copyright, trade secrets, patent, and rights of publicity. Those are the real world scenarios in which all these intellectual property fingers are interwoven into your startups. And if you have the ability to recognize those off the bat, you are at least 50-60% ahead of any of your competitors who don't have the foresight in order to plan for that. So the next question is, well, I have all this intellectual property. What do I do with it? Well, you have a trademark, whether it be design mark or whatever the mark may be. As a trademark owner, you have a duty to do a couple things. One is you have a duty to police your marks. That means that you just can't let the unauthorized use of your marks continue without trying to intervene and correct that use. If you don't take any action to correct that use or stop that use, then you can run the risk of losing the rights in your trademark. But more importantly, when you start registering or developing this intellectual property, you need to decide, how am I going to monetize it? Okay, how am I going to transfer this intellectual property into money? One way you can do it is just by using it all internally. Okay, I'm going to use it internally, and that's how I'm going to set myself apart from my competitors. Customers are going to love me. They're going to come to me, buy my products, etc. Another way you can do it is called licensing. That's where you give others permission to use your intellectual property. You can do that for patents, you can do it for copyrights, and you can do it for for trademarks. All right. So, for instance, I own trademarks for clothing. That's class 25. And I have a shoe manufacturer that comes to me and says, "Zach, I love your trademark. I want to do a shoe deal with you." All right. And you say, "Well, okay, we'll do that." You can go ahead and license your mark to that licensee, that shoe company, to go ahead and use your mark. And you'll have to build certain quality control provisions into that to make sure that they're using the mark in such a way as it doesn't hurt the mark, and that they're maintaining appropriate quality standards. And in return, they're going to pay you a fee. And that fee is usually based on their sales of the product bearing your mark. So that's one way that you can go ahead and monetize it. Now, interestingly, although you weren't in the shoe business before, now you are. And now you can go ahead and expand that trademark registration to where you just had it for clothing. Now you can expand it to shoes because you have a licensee that's using that mark. And you can start building and building from there until you start really establishing your footprint. So that's one way with a trademark. With a copyright, licensing is done all the time. You have music licenses to where you have a bar and grill. Bar and grill wants to have a performer sit there and play cover songs. Well, performer doesn't carry a license with them. It's not required to. It's the venue's responsibility to have a performance license so that music can be played at that establishment. And there's various factors that go into how that's calculated, but that's one way of doing it. Licenses, you have book deals to where you can enter into an agreement with a publisher to where the publisher will go ahead and pay you royalties if you agree to enter into some type of exclusivity with them for the rights for your book. So now we're talking about monetizing. Patents. You own a patent. You may have never developed the actual product itself, but you find that someone out there really wants to be able to develop that product. They may do one of two things. They say, "You know what? I'd like to go ahead and either license that patent for you for a reasonable royalty, where they'll pay you a certain amount of money for each product sold. Sometimes they'll include, it could be a flat fee per year, a yearly fee, could be based on sales. You can incorporate certain types of mandatory minimums that they have to pay you each year in order for that license to maintain, to remain valid. There are certain instances where you can say, "You're going to be my only licensee." It's called an exclusive licensee. It means I'm not going to license this intellectual property to anyone else. You're it. Generally, they have to pay a higher premium for that because now you're forgoing the right to go ahead and allow others to use that mark or use that intellectual property. If it's a non-exclusive, then you can go ahead and license it to as many people that are willing to pay for it. So once again, we're monetizing. So at the end of the day, I think the main purpose that you need to draw from what we discussed is just identify that these issues are out there. Because once you do that, then you can make your business decision on which direction you want your business to go in. You can develop your intangible assets. You can develop your brand.
And you can obtain the necessary protections to prevent others from swooping in
who may be, you know, have more money, more power, but yet you're still protected because you own the rights. So,
I say good luck with your
all your not-for-profits, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Zach.
Sure.
I have a question. On the state trademark, is it said it needs to be used in some form or fashion beforehand? Does it need to be monetized beforehand?
No.
Do you need to be making money?
You don't have to be making, well, you need to sell. Remember, selling is not necessarily making money.
Right.
If it costs me $2 to make the good and I sell for $1.50, I'm not making money on it. But yes, you need to be using it first. And what usually the best way to, the basis for that, if it's a trademark that's actually affixed to a good, then it's the first sale.
So what about service?
Service, generally if you're using it on your website in the upper right-hand corner of the of the website, that's where most marks are, then that would be considered use as well. I believe they require three instances of actual use, so you could do your website and maybe two flyers or something like that. That would satisfy use in that sense. But you still need to go ahead and make sure that in this instance that there is no conflicting mark on the state registry or the federal registry. Because remember, someone who outside of Florida is on the federal registry can reach down into Florida because they have national rights. And likewise, with a federal registration, you have the ability to file what they call an intent to use, which means that I'm not actually using this mark yet, but I have a bona fide intent that I'm going to. And what that does is it puts a place marker for you in line so that someone who comes in after you can't jump ahead of you. You still have your place marker until you actually begin use. So it will proceed through the registry system. And then at the end, you'll get what they call a notice of allowance. You won't get your registration yet until you begin use. Then you'll have up to 3 years to begin using it. And the trademark office likes to pop you $150 every 6 months in order to get those extensions up to 3 years.
And does a logo and, let's say, a slogan need to be branded as well, or just...
That's an interesting question, because I always find that a lot of clients, I like to over-trademark. I am a strong believer having a brand and going with it, because you can have a strong brand, what they call a house mark, and then have your slogans under it, which you can change from month to month. So the question is, you know, how source identifying is that slogan? Do you think that slogan's going to be? DBA?
Let's say your logo is your acronym, but your DBA, does that need to be trademarked as well?
Generally, not everyone does it, but I mean, if you're using a DBA, that's generally the trademark that you want to use for your business. Whether or not it's a protectable trademark right would depend upon the actual name itself, but yeah, that's generally the way it works. For instance, like Iron Man, everyone has heard of Iron Man. Okay, they don't operate under Iron Man. It's not Iron Man Inc. It's World Triathlon Corporation. Okay, so their brand is Iron Man, and they'll have multiple different marks over there for all different types of products. But at the end of the day, the house brand is Iron Man. Any other questions?
I have one.
Sure.
So I sold my business a few years back, mm-hmm. and I really liked the logo. The person that I sold the business to, I didn't realize at the time, I thought he was going to actually work the business. He was a business consultant. And I was really unfamiliar with I was new to business. I didn't know a lot. I should have did more research before I sold the business. Kind of learner error type thing. He's not even using the logo. So I think it was a service type industry. And I think he just sold the accounts more or less.
Mm-hmm.
Does it depend on how the contract was written? Because there was no trademarks on my logo or anything like that. And I don't think the logo is being used anymore, or it was never used, more or less, when he purchased the business.
Were you using the logo at the time you sold the business?
Yes.
Okay. So remember, we have registered in common law. So if you're using a logo as a source identifier for your business, then there's common law rights into it.
Okay.
Okay, so there you have trademark rights.
Okay.
So you enter into a sale to this other person. Various different types of sale. There's equity and there's the asset purchase. Which one was it?
I
got to
go back in.
Okay.
Well, you know, I didn't know too much about
sure.
it at the time, and probably made some mistakes, learning curve. You know?
Equity purchase is when someone wants to go ahead. Did you guys already discuss this? Did you discuss this?
No, I don't think so. Could you talk about the difference between buying the stock and buying the assets?
Yeah. There's two ways that you can buy a corporation. I'm not a corporate attorney, but I do a lot of corporate transactions because of the IP aspects of them. But there's an asset purchase, which a lot of companies like, a lot of buyers like, because you just buy the things that you want and leave everything you don't want behind with the selling corporation. When you buy the stock, you buy the entire corporation. As is, with all the bad stuff that comes along with it, with all the debts. Okay, so you said that there that you believe that this person is no longer using the trademark. Well, once you stop using the trademark for a certain amount of time, then that trademark is deemed to be abandoned. Okay? Rule of thumb is usually a couple, I think it's 2 years. I don't recall exactly off the top of my head, but one of the aspects of abandonment is that the person did not have an intent to resume the use of that mark. So there is a possibility that that trademark was abandoned. There is the possibility that the trademark assignment was invalid.
He actually changed the logo. Kept the name, but the logo changed.
Well, if he changed the logo, then that's pretty... I don't know all these specifics. But if he changed the logo and is no longer using that logo... and has rebranded under something else, then there's the possibility that he's no longer using it, and therefore he's no longer has trademark rights in it. There's that possibility based upon what you told me. But I don't know.
It would have to be proven if they came down to a litigation or something of that sort, if there was a conflict, if I took it back and started using it.
Well, I don't know if you're offering competitive service.
Right.
So if you're a competitor to me, you're darn straight, I flex that.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Hi. I work for a national television network, and I'm the channel branding manager, so I'm just kind of like always dealing with like designs and logos and rebrands and all this stuff that go out on television. And it's difficult because like a lot of the designers think that, oh, we'll just go on Google and get this image and cut it out and put it in this graphic and all this stuff, and you know, obviously that's not okay. But there are situations where, like, for example, we acquired all of these James Bond movies, so we were having, like, a Bond-a-thon, and we created a special graphics package for it. And, like, one of the designers went online and actually found the font that was used, like, the 007 font, and it was just, like, this whole thing, like, to me, it didn't seem safe to use, even though they're like, oh, well, we found it online and we actually bought it. But it's, like, what's the best way to actually find out if something like that is like legit or not?
Well, you said you bought the package of James Bond movies to go ahead and package them and I guess air them, right?
Yeah.
Right. Well, when you buy those rights, you have to see what type of marketing rights that you have as well.
Yeah, they will typically get creative assets and stuff, but in that case, we didn't get anything.
You didn't get anything. Well, then I would be suspect as to, I don't know if the 007, the font, is something that which they have trademark rights over. I kind of remember it a little bit, but I'm not sure how source identifying it is or whether or not it's protected by copyright. If it is under those two, then no, you shouldn't be using it. But there are avenues to try to trace back as to who has those rights. More generally than not, it would be the production company. It's either the movie house or the production company, for instance, Warner Brothers, whoever distributes those rights, who is it?
MGM.
So if MGM distributes those rights, they usually have like marketing rights and all that in their bundle of rights to be able to grant to others. So that would probably be a good start. There are areas in the internet that you can go to get like photographs that are in the public domain. You can just search for them. And there's a site for public domain. Just make sure you read that little terms and conditions, that little button at the bottom of the footer of the web page no one reads. And Shutterstock, too. Shutterstock, Getty Images, you can license all rights from them. Likewise, I find their licensing agreements to be a little complicated and confusing.
Yeah, our lawyers for my company don't even allow us to use some of those. Like, there's only two stock photo or video companies that we're allowed to use, and the other ones are just like we've been cut off from all of them.
That's probably because you're doing broadcasting over such a wide range that it requires a direct negotiation with Getty Images. But if you're doing, let's say if you're running something on your website for a month, you can get ahead and get a license from these individuals to go ahead and use it for a month. So, I mean, that's one way to clear it. I think you had a question as well?
Yeah. I'm starting this up. Well, the company was a friend of mine, and another friend was over in Colorado who also started a clothing company. If we collaborated and made sales together, how would we divide, how would we report our sales on tax forms? Would it be all of it on each one, or split the difference and put it on that?
Oh, you're talking the corporate structure now. It depends how you're operating. Do you have an actual corporation set up? And I'm not giving you tax advice on this one. I'm just inquiring. Do you have a corporation set up?
No.
No?
No, yeah, we're setting that up.
Okay, well, then you need to, I hate to say this, you had to meet with a corporate, with a tax attorney to decide which is the best structure for you to set up to take advantage of any type of tax advantages and to shield yourself from any type of potential individual liability. So that's the way to do it. Anyone else? No.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, guys. Thanks.